fans here, it appears.
I hope so.
Senator, you have said that to receive military aid from the United States, Israel has to treat the Palestinian people with respect. And you've also said that you would leverage U.S. assistance to end racism that you've seen lately in Israel. I was hoping you could be a little more specific about when and why you'd condition U.S. assistance to Israel. Is the goal to stop annexation, settlement construction, something greater than that?
Well, thank you for the question, Tommy. And if I can begin. It's okay, I like to...
Please. You know,
it's hard to talk when you're sitting, you know, I just like to stand. Just a couple of things, then I'll get to your good question. We have 3 hours, is that what I understood
yes,
it was?
Sir.
Okay. Number one, I am very proud to be Jewish and look forward to being the first Jewish president in history of this country. Number two, as a people who have suffered for century after century, not to mention the horrors of the Holocaust in which my father's family was wiped out, as were many of your family, if there is any people on earth who understands the danger of racism and white nationalism, it is certainly the Jewish people. And if there is any people on earth who should do everything humanly possible to fight against Trump's effort to try to divide us up by the color of our skin or our language, our religion, or where we were born, if there's any group on earth that should be trying to bring people together around a common and progressive agenda, it is the Jewish people. And Tommy, in light of that belief, this is what I believe. As a kid, I spent many months on a kibbutz in Israel. I believe absolutely, not only in the right of Israel to exist, but the right to exist in peace and security. That's not a question. But what I also believe is the Palestinian people have a right to live in peace and security as well. And it is not, let me underline this because it will be misunderstood. It is not anti-Semitism to say that the Netanyahu government has been racist. That's a fact. That is a fact. So what I believe, Tommy, at a time when we spend, I think it's $3.8 billion on military aid to Israel, we have a right to say to the Israeli government that the United States of America and our taxpayers and our people believe in human rights, we believe in democracy, we will not accept authoritarianism or racism. And we demand that the Israeli government sit down with the Palestinian people and negotiate an agreement that works for all parties. So my proposal in terms of Israeli-Palestinian efforts is not a radical proposal. All it says is that we need an even-handed proposal for both people. What is going on in Gaza right now, for example, is absolutely inhumane. It is unacceptable. It is unsustainable. So I would use the leverage. $3.8 billion is a lot of money. And we cannot give it carte blanche to the Israeli government, or for that matter, to any government at all. We have a right to demand respect for human rights and democracy.
I would stand, but I don't know that I have the same degree of energy.
Well, you're a little bit old, Ben.
I know.
I don't want to raise the age issue.
Yeah. Well, it looks like you're in better shape than I am. I also want to look at it from the other perspective, which is, you know, in addition to everything else that we've seen in recent years, we've seen the Trump administration essentially downgrade our relations with the Palestinian people. You know, when they moved the embassy to Jerusalem, essentially that eliminated the consulate that was our diplomatic representation. We've seen efforts to cut funding for assistance to the Palestinian Authority, and just, you know, the wholesale kind of degradation in our relationship with the Palestinian people. How would you go about engaging the Palestinian people, and would that potentially involve, you know, the U.S. contemplating some form of recognition of a Palestinian state, or putting forward what we think the outlines of a two-state solution looks like?
Well, first thought, it's instinctual. What Trump has done, you know, and I don't want to waste time talking about Trump, but is disgraceful. So as President of the United States, of course we reach out, and we established relations, understanding, by the way, that it is not only Netanyahu's government that has been a problem. Let us recognize there has been corruption in terms of Hamas and the Palestinian Authority. Let's recognize that as well, all right? But certainly our job is to understand that if we're going to bring peace and stability to that region, if we're going to have people working in common on issues like environmental degradation and climate change and water, we of course have got to recognize the Palestinians and reach out to them in ways that are fair. And I would undo the damage that Trump did in terms of our relationship to the Palestinian people.
And you mentioned Gaza, where, you know, their projections, you know, the UN and others, that it's essentially becoming unlivable. It's a place where people are living in such dire and destitute circumstances that basic needs cannot be reached. How would you approach trying to get humanitarian assistance into Gaza, trying to lift pieces of this blockade that catch stuff that clearly has no military uses? What is the approach of a President Sanders to the situation in Gaza?
My understanding is youth unemployment in Gaza, what, 60-70%? Water situation, dismal. People literally cannot freely leave the area. And my solution is to say to Israel is you get $3.8 billion every single year. All right? If you want military aid, you're going to have to fundamentally change your relationship to the people of Gaza. In fact, I think it is fair to say that some of that $3.8 billion should go right now into humanitarian aid in Gaza. Look, when you have an unsustainable situation, who is going to deny that when youth unemployment is 60%, when people have no hope, when people cannot literally leave the region, who can think for a moment that you're not laying the groundwork for continued violence? So I think for Israel's benefit, not to mention the Palestinians, we need a radical intercession in Gaza to immediately allow for economic development, to allow for a better environment, to allow for better education, to give people hope there. And that is something that we must do as soon as humanly possible.
Senator, yesterday, President Trump announced that the U.S. military had taken out Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the head of ISIS. And, yeah, I think you can cheer for that. And I think we all can agree that that's unequivocally a good thing for the world. But I think also Ben and I can say with some humility that we were in the White House when bin Laden was killed. And we heard countless meetings about senior al-Qaeda terrorists being taken off the battlefield, and yet ISIS is now in more places. There are more Sunni extremists now than before 9/11. So, you know, security against terrorist groups like al-Qaeda, support for Israel's security, for the U.S. security. How would you approach the war against ISIS and other extremist groups that target both countries differently than President Trump or even President Obama?
And that is, I don't know that anybody has a magical answer to your question.
No, of course.
It's a difficult question if we think about it. But let me just say this. I am proud and apologize to nobody for when I first came to the Congress, the House of Representatives, in 1991, one of my very first votes was to vote against the first Gulf War. Okay? And I did that not because I was sympathetic to Saddam's invasion of Kuwait. But I thought when you had the entire international community united, you could get them out of Kuwait without introducing American troops in the area. Second of all, I helped lead the opposition to the disastrous war in Iraq. Okay? And if you go back to what I said on the floor of the House, what I talked about is the destabilization that would take place. You don't have to be a genius or an expert in foreign policy to understand you were laying the groundwork for massive destabilization, and what ended up bringing about is literally the creation of ISIS and so many horrors, my God, in that part of the world. So I think, first of all, what we have got to do, and again, I do not profess to have any magical solutions. A lot of good people have worked on these issues for decades. But I think for a start, number one, the United States of America cannot do it alone. It requires international cooperation. And second of all, at a time when we are seeing right now in Lebanon and in Iraq, massive uprising, hundreds of thousands of people standing up against corruption, I think what we as a nation, as Americans, have got to do is to do everything we can to try to deal with the root causes of what drives people without hope into terrorism. And thirdly, of course, I am not unmindful of the military need. I'm not sitting here and saying, you know, provide health care and education, everything is great. That is not the case. We need to be vigorous in taking on and wiping out those terrorists who want to harm us and our allies. But I think you need a multifaceted approach which requires international cooperation, which requires working on issues of corruption, which is one of the breeding grounds for terrorism. So there's a lot to be done, but it should not simply be a military solution. It has to be multifaceted.
One of the things that we can anticipate is whoever the Democratic nominee is going to face some really ugly attacks on issues related to Israel. You, even though you're the first, I think, Democratic or first candidate for president who's Jewish to win a primary, have already faced attacks because people say people have endorsed you or are associated with BDS, or the government of Israel, at the request of the President of the United States, tried to prevent two members of Congress who've endorsed you from even traveling there, or did prevent them from traveling there. How do you try to change the conversation? I mean, you talked a lot about building a movement to change structurally our politics. How do you change this conversation about Israel and American politics that does feel so cynical and toxic, where there's a conflation of criticism of certain Israeli policies with anti-Semitism, where people try to hang guilt by association on everybody? How do you go about building the kind of campaign and movement that can hopefully lead us into the direction of a healthier way of dealing with this?
Well, I think being Jewish may be helpful in that regard.
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to be very hard for anybody to call me, whose father's family was wiped out by Hitler, who spent time in Israel, an anti-Semite. But I think, Ben, the answer to your question goes beyond dealing with Israel or the Middle East. So you're asking us how we bring people together in general,
yeah,
which goes back. And I am very proud to say, some may disagree with me, You know, I know that people think my agenda, what I'm fighting for, is radical and it's outside of the mainstream. The truth is, it is not. So if you want to know how you bring people together, you go, as I have and will go, into Republican districts and say to working people there, maybe white working class people, think we should raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour? They'll say, yeah, we should. Do you think we should have equal pay for equal work for women? And people will say, yeah. Do you think we should make public colleges and universities tuition free and cancel all student debt so your kids have an opportunity to get an education? They will say yes. Are you happy paying 10 times more for insulin in the United States than they do in Canada because the pharmaceutical industry is corrupt and engaging in price fixing? No, they're not happy. So my point is, what I believe, not just on foreign policy, we can bring people together, working class people, middle class people, around an agenda that works for all of us. You go to any district, go to the reddest district in this country, and you ask those folks, do you think Amazon, owned by the wealthiest person in America, made $11 billion in profit last year, did not pay a nickel in federal income taxes? Nobody thinks that that is appropriate. So I think we develop an agenda which includes a democratic foreign policy, which says we do everything humanly possible to avoid war. We invest in the State Department. We invest in negotiators and diplomacy. Not just continue to spend more on the military than the next 10 nations combined. And by the way, I am proud to tell you, I am the only Democratic candidate to have voted against all of Trump's military budgets.
We have time for one or two more. So, I mean, President Trump has said essentially that it's disloyal to Israel to vote for Democrats. Apparently, he's finally grasped the disloyalty trope that has been called anti-Semitic rightly in so many places. Bibi Netanyahu has fully embraced the Republican Party. You know, he has posters of himself and Trump up in Israel. Do you worry that Netanyahu has made support for Israel partisan? And do you worry that these attacks on Democrats will hurt members of Congress or, you know, candidates like yourself running for president?
Well, obviously, that's exactly what Trump has done and exactly what Netanyahu has done. But in both instances, I must say, you're looking at leaders, one who's going to be impeached, the other one who may end up in jail. So I don't know how much credibility they have, actually, in terms of integrity. Look, I don't like to comment on Trump because every other minute there's going to be another absurd tweet coming down the line. But to suggest that if you vote Democratic, you are somehow anti-Israel is just one more of an absurd position by the president. But I believe that in terms of foreign policy, the American people would like to see us investing in education and healthcare, not in endless wars. I believe the American people would like us not to be one-sided in our foreign policy in terms of Israel and the Palestinians, or I might say Saudi Arabia and Iran. All right? We are the most powerful, wealthiest nation on earth. We can use our leverage to bring people to the negotiating table. I'm not here. You guys know this better than I. This is tough stuff. Yeah. Don't hear me say, you know, I got the magic answer. I don't. But you are not going to make progress unless you bring people to the table. And I am impressed. In fact, I talked to Obama about this some years ago when he said, correct me if I'm wrong, that in Iran, for example, the young people are more pro-American than many other countries around the world. Why do we lose that opportunity? Why do we say that a brutal dictatorship like Saudi Arabia is our loving ally rather than bringing all sides to the table and trying to negotiate peace?
One more question. You know, it's really interesting, to think about the potential. Here you talk about the need for, again, a movement to change things. One of the things that we've noticed around the world is the coordination, frankly, among right-wing leaders with authoritarian tendencies. Bibi Netanyahu has quite a close relationship with Viktor Orban in Hungary. Donald Trump and Netanyahu obviously have a close relationship. You know, Putin and Trump, who knows what's going on there, right? Would you see part of your effort as president to build not just a progressive movement in this country, but to try to not by intervening in other countries, you know, picking candidates, but would you see a role in saying there needs to be a global progressive movement to counter this nationalist trend? And does that include, you know, in Israel, trying to reach out to young people as you do in this country and say, you know, here's what we need to do together?
Absolutely. Okay, now Ben raises a very, very important issue. I am not into conspiracy theory. I really am not. But if anybody thinks that there is not a coordinated effort among incredibly wealthy and powerful authoritarian leaders around the world, then you don't know what's going on. You got Putin, who is trying to destabilize American democracy and European democracy. You got MBS in Saudi Arabia sitting on God knows how much money. And by the way, oil has a lot to do with its access as well. And you got Trump here. And I think when democracy and human rights are on the defensive all over the world, that of course we need a president to bring people from around the globe together fighting against oligarchy and a handful of incredible wealthy people controlling a lot of our world's economy and standing up for human rights, whether it's in Hong Kong, in China, in Russia, in Saudi Arabia, in Hungary. The idea that the leader of Israel would be in collusion with an anti-Semitic leader in Hungary is beyond belief, but that speaks to your point. So we have an enormous amount of work in front of us, and again, none of this stuff is easy, and I'm not making any promises to you that on day one we solve it all. But if there is anything that our country proudly has stood for, it has been a beacon of hope for my father, who came to this country at the age of 17 to flee anti-Semitism and extreme poverty. But it has been a beacon of hope for people all over the world who looked at America because of our democracy, because of our belief in human rights, because of our belief in opportunity for all. That is the America we once were. And as president, I want once again people from all over the world to say, this is the United States of America. That is the country we want to emulate and become.
Senator Bernie Sanders.